So, welcome to this afternoon session. And welcome in particular to Ethan. So, I'll introduce him in a minute. First of all, Ethan's going to be talking about becoming a Green Party councillor as an expression of his values and Buddhist practice. And in September 2022, Ethan attended the Green Earth Awakening, Butterfield's Green Earth Awakening, and he had a kind of revelation. And I think he's going to tell us about that in his talk. He had a kind of revelation about what he was going to do with his life. And since then, he's been elected to the Bewdon Stratton Town Council in Cornwall as a Green Party councillor. And he started a climate conversations cafe, among other things. So I'd like to hand you over to Ethan. Welcome, Ethan.
Thank you, Santiago. I'm starting to feel a little nervous now. Thank you for coming, everybody. I really appreciate it. It's wonderful to have the opportunity to talk to you. But I think the most important thing I want to say is that I'm very grateful for HES actually existing, and this as a context being able to be possible. I think it's very important indeed. If it's all right with you guys, I'd like to start with a poem, just very briefly. It's a poem by Joanna Macy, who is the root teacher of the work that Reconnects, and it's called Grace and the Great Turning. When you act on behalf of something greater than yourself, you begin to feel it acting through you with a power that is greater than your own. This is grace. Today, as we take risks for the sake of something greater than our separate individual lives, we are feeling graced by other beings and by the earth itself. Those with whom and on whose behalf we act give us strength and eloquence and staying power we didn't know we had. We just need to practice knowing that and remembering that we are sustained by each other in the web of life. Our true power comes as a gift, like grace, because in truth it is sustained by others. If we practice drawing on the wisdom and beauty and strengths of our fellow humans and our fellow species, we can go into any situation and trust that the courage and intelligence required will be supplied. That's a poem that I discovered recently, and which I feel is indicative of the experience that I had. As Shantigarbha said, I went to the Green Earth Awakening in 2022. In the hills just outside Taunton. And while I was there, I attended a series of workshops on the work that Reconnects. And during one of them, I was sat in a role play with somebody who was playing a being from the future. Which was quite entertaining at the time, but they asked two questions. They said that in their time in the future, they had stories of how in our time there were extreme weather events, breakdown of climate processes, war, poverty, and the like. And did I know? And I sort of hesitated and said that, yes, actually, these are things that we live with and And if I was being honest, I know about these things in some space in my mind. And then came the question, what did you do? And in a way, the question broke me open slightly, because in acknowledging that the realities that we all know are real in our world today, it had brought to the forefront of my mind those realities. And I realized that I wasn't really doing much, if anything, to face those realities and to engage with them and to try to contribute to the resolution of those realities, or the healing of our world, if you will. And I wept. I wept for the reality that I had acknowledged. I wept for the suffering that is inherent in that in those realities. And I wept because there was an acknowledgement that I needed to do something to respond. There was a deep desire to respond to the reality that was there. So I, in the time that followed that, I joined the Green Party. I joined Greenpeace. I joined Liberty. I joined a number of organizations that seemed to be working for climate justice and human justice throughout the world. I vociferously read the books, as many books as I could get hold of, by Joanna, Macy. And I came to the realization that I had to change my life. I had to do something differently. Now, I changed my, one of the first things I did was change my banking. That was very, very simple to do, but seemed to be quite a straightforward, quite powerful choice to make. And around that time, Liz Truss came to power in Britain, and she brought forward a budget which was based on tax cuts for the rich, in many respects, primarily. And I feel quite awkward in telling you this, but I was furious. I felt furious. I'd had this experience at Green Earth Awakening, and I felt that I felt a sense of injustice and indignity in relation to witnessing increasing poverty in the nation. And it feels strange to tell you that, because obviously this is a Sangha event, and I'm talking about having felt very angry. It wasn't ill will, I don't think. I think it was more a desire for there to be justice. That felt very important. And actually, I received an email from the Green Party very shortly after that said, we shouldn't be investing in tax cuts for the rich. We should be investing in education, healthcare, and the environment. And that kind of drew me in and gave me a more skillful expression of what I was feeling, I think. And very shortly after that, I became aware that there was a by-election in my area, in my ward, in the area that I live in. And somehow I felt very challenged by that. I've been reflecting on the process that brought me to stand for election and to be elected. And it felt like I had been personally challenged. It felt like the world had created an opportunity or created conditions for me to step in and to take responsibility and to try to live out my values more. So I had this sort of internal experience of questions arising as to whether I was going to act in integrity in relation to the experience that I'd had at the Green Earth Awakening. It's funny to think about because nobody else knew about the experience. Nobody else knew that I was considering putting myself forward. So no one would have criticized me had I not acted, but somehow my own conscience was aware that there was an opportunity there to do something to, in a way to honor the experience that I had as within the work that Reconnects at the Green Earth Awakening. So there were questions getting louder and louder in my psyche, which were along the lines of, well, if not me, then who? And if not now, then when? And so I put myself forward for election. And I was elected unopposed, which means that nobody else stood. So I'm not sure if that means it was slightly a poison chalice or not. I don't know. But it also ironically means that nobody had to vote for me. So I feel a slight fraud talking to you today about having been elected when nobody actually voted for me, in truth. I can give you some reassurance that since I've been elected, a number of people said they would have voted for me. Hopefully that's true. So I found myself in this position of having a position or a title or I guess it's a position that comes with responsibility, but also comes with some influence. And so, of course, that for me, that brought up a lot of doubt, a lot of imposter syndrome, in truth. That's something that is very familiar. This thing of feeling just like a guy from Cornwall, just like everybody else, but then also feeling like I had a role to play. That's maybe not quite right, but there was a slight disconnect to start with between my personal experience of myself and what I presumed or imagined was involved with being a councillor or sitting on a council. It's been an interesting journey. It has been an interesting journey. The first thing I did was to join the Climate and Environment Forum of the council. I've been very fortunate in that the council itself is quite conducive to environmental or the many of the councillors are slightly left leaning and quite green in their perspectives. So it's quite a conducive environment for discussions around environmental concerns. So in joining the fact that there was even an environment and climate change forum in the council is in and of itself quite I was going to say revolutionary. Revolutionary is not the word. It's quite forward thinking, I think. It's a council that's already declared a climate emergency, has a 2030 net zero target and is working towards that in a very very practical, very proactive way. So in that respect, I feel that the conditions have been supportive for me to be able to bring climate concerns, bring motions and resolutions around the climate to the council. People are welcoming of that. The first resolution that I brought was for the council to sign up to the Fossil Fuel Non-Proliferation Treaty, which is a treaty that's based around a just transition away from fossil fuels. It's a treaty that is based in some respects on the principles of nuclear non-proliferation and the non-proliferation of weaponry. I've got the link here somewhere. I've got bear with me for a second. I'll put the link in the chat for those of you that are interested. And it was interesting bringing that as a resolution, because some people felt it was too tokenistic to bring. I had personally signed the treaty myself. I think I must have discovered it in the days after attending the Green Earth Awakening. I'd signed it myself. I was planning to lobby the council and my MP to sign it before I got elected. And it eventually passed unanimously, though I had to do some work one-to-one with at least one of the councillors who felt that the optics of a council like ours signing an international treaty were things that wouldn't be understood by residents. So again, I had a bit of a wobble and a bit of a period of doubt before I brought it. But actually, the council clerk said that he felt it was an act of civic leadership to bring the to bring the treaty to resolution. And it was unanimously passed. For me, the mechanics of being with or being on the council mostly involve emails and a lot of reading, attending a lot of meetings and liaising one to one with other councillors. Some of it is very mundane and very process driven. But as I was reflecting on the process of coming to this talk, one of the things that really came to mind was that I've been given the opportunity to influence the material conditions that my community experience. And in that respect, as long as that feels fundamental. I mean, this is the community that I'm originally from. I grew up here. I know a lot of people in the community. I've been in receipt of a lot of kindness and a lot of loving care over the years. My understanding of community and Sangha is very strongly influenced by my experience of living in this town and my experience of community here. So I've long felt a desire to contribute to the community itself. For me, service is a fundamental part of my practice. And I've previously worked in humanitarian response in Africa and Asia. I've previously been the chair of a refugee support group, the Bude refugee support group, actually, which sponsored two Syrian families to come and live in Bude after the outbreak of war in Syria. So service has always been fundamental for me, and it's fundamental to my expression of my practice. And this gives me an opportunity to serve my community. It's interesting at times to bring that perspective when there are definitely personality politics at play. Sometimes there are some quite big personalities on the council, and there can be quite significant clashes. I'm in the process of preparing for an ethics retreat at Padmaloka. So I'm heading there in the last days of November. And so I've been reflecting on my ethical practice and my the way the 10 pillars or the precepts, the way I live them out. And I was in a meeting a week or so ago when comments were made that I felt were unethical. I won't go into details, but one of the fellow councillors said that they were willing to undertake an action that I felt was very much an unethical action. And it was interesting because I'm still finding my voice in that context. And so I didn't actually speak. I didn't speak. I really don't want to tell you that. I'd rather be able to say, actually, what I did was I made comment that I didn't feel that was correct. but actually I wasn't able to live up to my aspiration in that moment. So it still remains a challenge. And in answer to the question of, or in thinking about how my practice, how becoming a counsellor affects my practice or is an expression of my practice, I think the word that comes to mind is confidence, is shraddha. The more I'm able to have confidence in my own practice, I think the more being a counsellor can be an expression of that practice and of my deepest values. I've long had a deep, deep longing to be able to contribute to the preservation and enrichment of life. And this is a singular expression of that. And it's an imperfect expression of that. It will, whatever I'm doing will always be an imperfect expression of that desire, I think. I remain sort of in that space between, or moving in that space between my ideals and the muddy reality of life. And yeah, I don't really know what more to say than that. It's a continued attempt to try to do something in response to the suffering that I witness. The thing that I'm most interested in at the moment is trying to, and it seems strange to say this because this is an Earth Sangha event, but actually the thing that is most gaining my energy and my interest at the moment is trying to source funding for children experiencing poverty who don't have access to food during the school day. It feels fundamentally important to me. And at the same time, Bude, the town that I'm from, is, and the town that I serve and represent, is the town that is most likely to be affected by sea level rise in the whole of the UK, which is something that I found out since I've been a councillor. So there is a lot of work to do. And hopefully I can bring some of my dharmic experience and practice to that. But it will always be an imperfect offer. That's the thing that feels truest to say somehow. I mean, if you told me 18 months ago that I would be talking to an online conference as a representative of a town council, or as myself, having been elected as a town councillor, I would never have believed you. And there are times when I still don't believe that it's true. So in a way, it's hard to speak to it and speak about it, because I still don't necessarily believe it. I still find it hard to understand at times. But I had a whole lot of ideas of what I was going to say, and I garble that I've written for us fairly lengthy as to what I was going to say, and I'm not sure if I've said any of it. application internet stable. Can you still see and hear me? Yeah, I think I was in the process of just saying that that I had prepared a talk that seems to differ from what I've actually said. So I'm not sure if I've been able to communicate the experience very clearly. The plan was to go into breakout rooms to do some activities, but there aren't too many of us, so maybe we could stay together and do those activities here. I'd love to hear people's if people are feeling inspired at the moment as to the things that are inspiring. Just the open sentence, what I'm feeling inspired by at the moment would be really helpful. I find sharing inspiration really fundamentally nourishing and resourcing. I know it's not always easy to feel inspired and to share inspiration when the world is as it is, but is there anyone that would be willing to share some inspiration? Helen?
Yes, I was inspired. I couldn't go to the conference middle day today because I was doing a die-in at Brighton City Centre. It was a die-in. And I was inspired by meeting people who think the same as me. So, you know, it's so it's connection, isn't it? Connection and I do a lot with Extinction Rebellion, but this was not Extinction Rebellion. This was more ceasefire sort of related stuff. So I realized I was really inspired by other people, listening to other people, to the talks and things like that. So, yeah, connection, I think, inspires me.
Anybody else?
No, I could say a few things. I've been really enjoying following the program a little more this time around, and as I've mentioned earlier, just the fact that I'm seeing all the familiar faces, like yourself, Ethan, and Bhaktapriya, and of course having Sanchikaba here, Gunnar Keta earlier, and I really pick up on Gunnar Keta. Actually, the way he talk, being lying in a snowy hill somewhere in Norway, next to the fire, presenting this highly important material, and what sort of really sort of stayed with me is that image of the bridge that was emblematic of the main principles that we need to implement in our communication as activists, and holding our truth while keeping the dialogue going, which is very importantly harmonize, it follows the principles of harmonizing speech, and another thing is just seeing that image of the Avalokiteshvara with all the little faces of the order members, and we're doing this thing, it's not individually. Being individuals, of course, as Bhante taught us, through individuals, but we're not doing it on our own.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing. Helen, another hand.
Well, I was just saying, I'm also inspired by people's honesties about their own accounts, like yours, for example, imposter syndrome or whatever. You know, I can relate to these things, and the same with the other speakers we've had. Everyone has a different take, and it's lovely to have that honesty. So again, I think it's connection, isn't it? And talking about it.
Thank you. Well, I was reflecting on the process of trying to develop a talk, and I did experience quite a lot of doubt, I must admit, and I asked Shanti Garber if it was possible to have a chat, and he was very reassuring. Actually, it was really helpful. So thank you, Shanti Garber, once again. But the thing that came up is that I don't feel qualified to talk of anything other than my own experience. I'm not a Dharma teacher. I'm trying to live as dharmically as possible, as ethically as possible, and practice meditation as regularly as I can. But I've been reading Ratna Ghosh's 10 Pillars or 10 Precepts book in preparation for the retreat that I'm going on. And he talks about the difference between teaching the Dharma and giving the Dharma. And I guess that's one of the things that I didn't say in the talk itself, but if there's any possibility that I can, through my own practice, give the Dharma to the people around me, and through being a councillor to the council and to my community, then that is what I most want from my practice, I think. Were there any questions? Was there anything that anyone was interested in that I didn't really cover? A bayonetry?
Yes, thank you. Yes, because I'm not from the UK, so I tried a bit to understand the situation in this council. You've been elected, there was not an opponent. And I try to compare it with the situation here. So if in Amsterdam we have a council, I think of 45 people, and they all are being elected on one day, and they have to campaign, etc. So how can I understand how it is in your situation, just to have a better idea?
So I think we are 18 or 19 on the council, on the town council. And I was elected as a by-election. So one of the council members had resigned. So there was the individual place up for election. And yeah, I was the only person who stood. Strangely.
So that's different from here, because here you have got the representatives of the political parties, and if somebody is leaving, the next number on the list, who was originally on the voting list, is stepping in. So that's what I didn't know. Now I understand. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
It's completely different here.
If there is a little more time, it was really great to hear from you about the project, the fundraising for the kids, lunches or whatever the food program was. Be really great to hear about any other projects you're currently involved with.
Yeah, okay. So I found out that childhood poverty in North Cornwall is nearly 7% higher than the national average. And from Bristol down to Cornwall, a third of children experiencing poverty don't receive free school meals. So they don't have access to food during the school day, many of them. And that to me seems like a fundamental basic for children to be able to grow up and live dignified lives. You know, just having access to food seems so obvious. I've been liaising with the schools, and I brought a paper to the council, but we had an emergency budget paper the day before, so I wasn't able to bring it, which I was very disappointed about. But it's something that is very much still on the agenda for me. Other things that I've been working on are, I should have said this, but I'm working on a resolution to bring an ethical procurement policy into action for the council, on the basis of donut economics, which I missed the talk yesterday, but it's very much in mind, because the council still use, and this is not a criticism of anyone or anything, but the council still uses Amazon for a number of purchases, which small purchases, but when the UN are criticizing an organization or a company, it doesn't feel right for me if our council is giving that organization taxable funds or taxation funds. So that's the next thing that I'm working on, bringing an ethical procurement policy into fruition. Thanks for asking, Yev.
So Ethan, like Helen, I wanted to appreciate your honesty, what I receive as your honesty, and your willingness to say, well, I don't know, and this is my experience, and this is what I'm doing. And I, yeah, that for me, I enjoy that sense of integrity. I appreciate that. And I also appreciated hearing a situation where your integrity was challenged, where somebody said something and for whatever reason you didn't speak up, so you're still dealing with those challenges. Yeah, still facing those challenges. Yes, I appreciate that. And I guess I do have a question, which is, what would you say to somebody perhaps on this call, or somebody in the order or movement, or anybody who's thinking about engaging in local politics in the way that you have done, and that they haven't made up their mind, they haven't decided, so what would you say to them?
That's a really good question. That's a really, really good question. I would, the first thing that comes to mind is that I'd intended to rejoice in and give thanks for Loka Bandhu, who I met through Butterfield this year, and who is the mayor or deputy.
Currently deputy mayor in Glastonbury, yes.
Deputy mayor of Glastonbury. So it is possible to be an order member and be involved in local politics. It is a possibility. I think it can be an expression of practice, a vehicle for the expression of one's practice. I'm not quite sure what I mean by that, but it can be a context for continuing practice. It will test it at times, I'm sure. But I don't think there's a contradiction in terms between the two, between being an order member and being a practicing Buddhist and being involved in local politics.
Hmm.
I think local politics is an area where people can have a direct influence on their community in a positive way. Hmm. National politics feels more complex somehow. And I would say that I also believe that politics, local politics in particular, well, no, not in particular, but local politics could benefit from having people practicing the Dharma who are involved. And it won't necessarily, and there's that space between the ideal of things being simple and straightforward and the muddy reality of the systems and processes of local government.
Thank you. So some of you may know, and some of you don't know, that that Banti or Sangharakshana, when he was asked about involvement, Buddhists being involved in politics, he had a similar perspective to you, Ethan, that he thought it was more possible to get involved in local politics, where you'd have more likely to have a personal connection with the people who voted for you, and also that they might actually be able to meet you or communicate with you, you know, before or after being elected. He thought, and the influence of party politics being less than on a national stage. So he thought it was more possible. But I think in some on some occasions he was encouraging of people getting involved in politics, but on a local level. And he thought it was much more difficult to keep your integrity in national politics, where party politics plays a much more significant role. And being a member of a party means signing up to a party agenda, a party line about things. And sometimes you might agree with those things, and sometimes you won't agree with those things. Nevertheless, you know, that becomes much more significant in on a national level, on a broader scale. So those were the kind of issues that I remember hearing him discuss, some years ago now. But yeah, I just wanted to say that he had a similar kind of take, that it was more possible to engage in local politics and keep your integrity.
Yeah, I would like to add on this. Of course, there are. Well, I fully agree with what you say about local politics and national politics. Yeah. And I think it's similar with NGOs, other organizations, unions or whatever. So there are many ways to get involved in social or political activism. And for me, being a unionist, this is, this whole issue is, I have maybe similar questions like Eden. I wonder, as I said, I agree with what Banti said and what you said about, and Ethan said about being an activist on a local level, being and following the precepts is much easier than on a national level. But I wonder if we want to make a real difference in the world, then. And maybe at some point one has to go further than the local level. And I just want to say it's an open question to me. How far, so to speak, how far can you go without being corrupted or on the other side without being burnt out?
I guess that we'd need to address that on a case, on an individual basis, you know, sort of how I remember I got involved in party politics when I was at university, and within about a year I realized that I wasn't going to be able to keep my integrity, simply because the next step involved getting votes from people and you know, relating to people on the basis of trying to get their votes rather than on the basis of friendship or anything else, you know, sort of. So at that point I realized I needed to sort of step back and just concentrate on my Buddhist practice. That was how I arranged my life, I guess, you know. But at the same time, I agree. I don't want to give up on making a difference in the world in one way or another. And so I'm still, here I am, I'm still at it. Yeah. Ethan, do you want to comment on that? It's your show, come on. Ethan, do you want to comment on it?
I think, well, with what you said about gaining votes, that chimes. And the first thing that came to mind was, God, yeah, actually, I was so lucky not to have to campaign on the basis of getting people's votes. There is an importance to it. I think integrity is the word that you used and which comes to mind most. It's how does one maintain one's integrity in relation to a context where actually not everybody is acting with integrity and not everybody wishes to act with integrity. Mm. There are different motivating factors. But I also think that when you act with integrity in a context like that where others are not or may not wish to, then actually that can shine a light on the context, on the situation, and can present another way. Not always easy.
I totally agree that, you know, acting skillfully for the benefit of those who are not acting skillfully, you know, that's a powerful practice. Okay.
Well, we've got like 3 minutes left.
Yes. Any last comments? Any last orders from anybody? Any comments or reflections?
Well done, Ethan.
Yeah.
Thank you and good luck.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, all power to your elbow, as they say, Ethan.
I also just want to say thank you to everybody for coming. It obviously makes it easier it makes it slightly more nerve-wracking, but it's also better when there are people to talk to and to hear from. And also I really want to thank you, Shanti Garba, for your efforts and for making this happen. So
you're very welcome, Ethan. Yes, very happy to have you and your voice here. Okay, shall we give Ethan a virtual wave? You can also unmute. Thank you. Thank you very much, Ethan.
Thank you all.
Yeah. And back here at 5 p.m. UK time, that's in half an hour, for the concluding session and puja. It'll be a Shambhala Warrior mind training versus puja. All right. Thank you again, Ethan. Bye now.